Welcome back to Faytene TV and friends. Today we're discussing online censorship and the Federal Online Harms Act with lawyers Barry Bussey from First Freedoms Foundation and Josh Dehaas from the Canadian Constitution Foundation.
I think this is really concerning because who's going to take that risk of potentially going to jail because somebody else thinks that their speech might be hateful in the future? Controversial ideas sometimes turn out to be correct in the long run. It's only people who are willing to sort of put their necks out there and say, I think the mainstream view is wrong, who lead to, you know, lasting change in the end.
It's something that we have learned through history. People have very strong opinions, and when they go to parliament, they speak, and there's to be freedom of speech in parliament, and we need to be able to do it without having the swords reaching each other. What this is doing is giving every citizen a sword, and that's a problem.
The Federal Minister of Justice in Canada has just tabled Bill C-63, an act to enact the Online Harms Act. It received its first reading on February 24, 2024. The Parliament of Canada's website states that Bill C-63 is an act to enact the Online Harms Act, to amend the Criminal Code, the Canadian Human Rights Act, and an act respecting the mandatory reporting of internet child pornography by persons who provide an internet service, and to make consequential and related amendments to other acts. Protecting children, obviously that sounds amazing. No one would disagree with that part of the bill. However, also embedded in the act are several other things which many lawyers across Canada are raising concern about. One such thing is that the act would create a tribunal whereby Canadians could report other Canadians who they feel may say something hateful that could cause harm to another person or group of people. Similar legislation existed prior in around 2013, but was removed by the Harper government because the legislation was being abused. If C-63 is passed, complaints could be filed anonymously with the tribunal, and those who are accused, if found guilty, could be ordered to pay tens of thousands of dollars to the complainant and to the government of Canada. The act also states that those who incite genocide could be forced to serve jail time, perhaps even up until a life sentence. Well, here today to discuss the details of the act and the possible implications of the bill are lawyers Barry Bussey and Josh Dehaas. Barry Bussey is the founder of First Freedoms Foundation, and Josh Dehaas serves as legal counsel for the Canadian Constitution Foundation. Both of these nonprofit organizations serve Canadians through advocacy and litigation to protect our constitutional rights and freedoms, not the least of which are freedom of thought, belief, faith, and speech. Thanks for joining us for this very important discussion and very eye-opening discussion on the Online Harms Act. Let's get to it. Well, I know this is going to be a very eye-opening conversation. Really appreciate your guys' time today. We've got Josh Dehaas from the Canadian Constitution Foundation and Barry Bussey, none other than from First Freedoms Foundation. Well, guys, first off, for our viewers, for many of our viewers, this will be a first meet for both of you guys. And so why don't we just start real quick with giving us a bit of an update on who you are, what your organizations do, and then we're gonna start talking about this bill, C-63. So, Josh, why don't you go first?
Yeah, so I'm counsel with the Canadian Constitution Foundation, and we are a legal charity that defends Canadians' constitutional rights and freedoms through litigation, but also through public education. So happy to be here. I wish I wasn't here to talk about C-63, though, because it's a very big risk to freedom of expression in Canada.
Well, we appreciate your work, and thanks for your time today in advance here. Barry, tell us about your good work.
So First Freedoms Foundation, we started up in 2021, basically in response to what was going on in Canada during the 2021 election. We are centering around the issues of freedom of speech, freedom of religion, and inviolability of the person. And so we're very much interested in making sure that Canadians not only get information, but also have opportunity to get involved and make a difference in this country.
Yeah, amazing. And you are very familiar with the nonprofit sector. You worked with the four C's for quite some time and then pivoted into this. And we are so grateful for the work of both of your organizations defending the rights and freedoms of Canadians, you know, in the faith community, you know, have a huge conversation in this. So let's go to this Online Harms Act. For our viewers, first of all, if you could maybe explain some of the key things from the act that have caught your attention and why your organizations are focused on raising the alarm about this bill right now.
What this legislation does is tries to provide a new bureaucratic framework, and I mean bureaucratic. We're talking about starting up of a whole new digital safety commission for the country with a digital safety ombudsperson and also a digital safety office that's now going to be policing the internet for harm. But also what is fascinating is that this bill is done under the rubric of protecting against sexual exploitation of children and other pornographic, sexualized items that as a country and as a people, we're all very much concerned with. But it's what's coming in on the back of that. Amendments to the Canadian Human Rights Act, amendments to the Criminal Code that really, really cause a lot of concern. And I'm sure we'll get into those.
Yeah, absolutely. Josh, jump in right here. What is causing alarm for you and your organization with regards to this bill?
Yeah, I think we share a lot of the same concerns as Mr. Bussey. The biggest concern is this bringing back Section 13 of the Canadian Human Rights Act, which will allow regular Canadians who feel that somebody said something hateful or discriminatory, which is, you know, often very much in the eye of the beholder, to go to this commission, which is appointed government bureaucrats who will decide whether or not that was hateful. And the problem with this is you can face fines of up to $50,000. You can be forced to pay your accuser up to $20,000 in compensation for their hurt feelings over this supposedly hateful speech. And even if your complaint is dismissed, you still have to go through this process where you're hanging under a cloud of being accused of hate. And you might need to hire a lawyer to defend yourself against that. So that's sort of the big one. There's also a number of other really crazy and speech-chilling parts of this bill, including, you know, making a life sentence for being motivated by hate, committing any other sort of crime, even if it's a fairly minor crime. You could potentially do a life sentence if your motivation is determined to be hate. And obviously, you know, hate is a problem, and we don't want anybody to be hurt by hateful words. But again, it's sort of in the eye of the beholder, and it's really hard to know what speech is going to be considered hateful under the law or by one of these commissions. So it's a big bill, lots of stuff in it. Some of it's actually good, like trying to address child exploitation images, which no one can disagree with. But there's just so many aspects of it that are really kind of an attack on freedom of expression.
Yeah, and there are so many conversations within this. I really appreciate you pointing out the subjectivity of defining what hate is, because that can even change over time, right? Something that was considered hateful in the 50s or wasn't considered hateful in the 50s might have been considered hateful in the 80s. And like a lot of this stuff is progressive, right, with culture. And so who defines what hate is? That's a huge, huge conversation. But secondly, this whole thing of the omnibus bill, where there are parts of the bill that seem great, but other parts that create a massive cultural vulnerability when it comes to freedom of speech. And so there are many of our members of parliament that will be conflicted on this, right? Because if they vote against it, they'll be seen as, you know, supporting online sexual predators. And the general public might not understand that, hey, there's parts of this bill that can be weaponized, say, for example, against the clergy or against somebody who is a comedian who gets up and makes a joke about, you know, hockey players or something like that, right? So there's this weaponization aspect in the midst of something that has good elements, which makes it, you know, really important to understand. And so let's talk a little bit more about this tribunal and the vulnerabilities that that creates.
Well, the tribunal is basically it's a creation of a huge it has the potential for a huge bureaucracy that's now going to be regulating online hate. And it has tremendous amounts of power. It has power that's, first of all, the head of the of this commission is going to be equal to a head of a government department. It's going to be able to issue orders that's going to have the same effect as if it came out of the federal court. It's going to also be involved in having sweeping powers to go and investigate complaints. And I mean, these complaints are going to be such that they will have the power to go into people's place of business. They will be able to do it without a search warrant. Throughout the bill itself, it refers to the technical rules of evidence and all the rest that is going to be a lower threshold. So what we've got here is the creation of an organization that is extremely powerful, has the force of a state, has enforcement mechanisms that's going to be able to be brutal in its approach of seeking the information that it wants to garner, and very little oversight. There is one oversight of a warrant on someone's dwelling house. So you have to get a warrant for a dwelling house. But if it's a place of business, no problem. Just walk right in and you have no choice but to cooperate with the government inspectors and give them all of the information. They can take your computer. They can download everything that's there. I mean, it's just absolutely draconian in its approach.
Now, Josh, give us an example, a worst-case scenario example of how this could play out, just to help our viewers understand the practical outlay of this.
Yeah, so if we're talking about the commission and being able to make these civil complaints, we know what some of the worst-case scenarios look like because we've actually been through this before. This is very much just bringing back a piece of legislation that we had in Canada that people realized was being used to limit freedom of expression and was, you know, removed in 2014 and has now come back like a sort of zombie. One example is there was a Catholic magazine back in the debates about whether same-sex marriage should be legal or not. This was a big debate within Canada, and people were accused, a magazine was accused of, you know, homophobic hatred for having a position on same-sex marriage that was not the mainstream opinion. And another example, probably the most famous, was an author at Maclean's magazine who wrote an article called The Future Belongs to Islam. And this article made a somewhat controversial argument about Islam as a growing religion in Europe. And some Islamic people in Canada were offended by this. And so they went to the Human Rights Commission and they tried to seek financial compensation from a journalist simply for making an argument about a religion. And so we know that this gets weaponized very easily, and we already got rid of this law, so I don't know why suddenly we need to bring it back.
I have, in the practice of law, have seen people who are been known to basically earn a living by going after other individuals and bringing cases. And then what they would do is that they would then seek to have a settlement before the court date. And they were, even though the case is just a nuisance case, I have seen those kinds of individuals at play using the system. And the problem I see with this legislation is we could see that same kind of activity happen where unscrupulous individuals could use it as a means of basically earning an income. Now, I know that sounds bizarre, but we see it in the regular practice of law. And the way this is set up, there's, in my view, there's no question that reality is a concern going forward.
It's really important for us to not criminalize speech because those accusations fly really easily, and you don't want to have, you know, some government bureaucrats deciding whether or not you're allowed to say what you wanted to say.
We love Canada, and we want to see it strong for generations to come. That's why we do this show. We can't do it alone. We need your help. Unlike commercial TV, this program is 100% donor-funded. If you'd like to see more episodes produced on important issues for our nation, please consider signing up to be a monthly partner or giving a special gift today. Every gift makes a real difference, and all gifts are tax deductible. Together, we can build a better Canada for the future. Visit Faytene.tv or call 1-866-844-0844 to donate today.
So this is a terribly flawed piece of legislation, it would seem. And so what you're also flagging there, which I think is really important to circle back to, is the anonymity factor. So somebody can say, hey, I think Barry's going to say something really hateful about this community or that person. I'm going to file an anonymous complaint in the investigation process. I might actually earn $20,000 for bringing that accusation. My word. And Barry, you know, you are not anonymous in the process, obviously, that your reputation can be tarnished. And you also have to bear the burden of all the financial drain that could be involved in defending yourself. And there's no remuneration for that. There's no chance of you being compensated for that at the investigation level. Is that a good read of this legislation if it goes forward as is?
Yes, absolutely. And there's, okay, so there's also the, so that's the civil side, but then you've got the criminal side. So now we got the criminal code is going to be amended, and anyone can, with the permission of an attorney general or a crown attorney, be able to go ahead and file a complaint in provincial court. And the issue is now, it's not that you have committed a hate, but that you're likely to commit. And that's just unbelievable.
Yeah. Josh, weigh in on this.
Yeah, that's one of the most concerning aspects of the bill for us, is this idea that you might commit a hate speech crime in the future. So somebody, you know, maybe it's a civil society group that's concerned about Islamophobia, anti-Semitism, whatever it is, they could go to the AG and with the AG's permission, ask a judge on reasonable grounds, which is a fairly low standard. It's much lower than the balance of probability standard that you normally need to win a civil case, and say, this person is going to go and hold a rally where they might say something that is considered hateful towards transgender people. And therefore, you judge, need to put some conditions on them. And the judge can put conditions on them, like, you know, stay away from this place, don't hold your rally, or you're going to go to jail, you know, stay at home at night, have a curfew, or you're going to go to jail. Hand over your guns, do drug tests, all of these different conditions. An ankle monitoring bracelet, can you imagine, just because you might commit some speech in the future that might be hateful? And I think this is really concerning because even if it doesn't happen all that often, who's gonna take that risk of having an ankle monitoring bracelet or potentially going to jail because somebody else thinks that their speech might be hateful in the future? And, you know, the whole point of freedom of expression is because controversial ideas sometimes turn out to be correct in the long run. You know, what's popular today might turn out to be wrong. It might be that is actually, you know, what's immoral and what we shouldn't be doing. And it's only people who are willing to sort of put their necks out there and say, I think the mainstream view is wrong, who lead to, you know, lasting change in the end. So just this chill on speech, it's really frightening. I don't think I've seen anything like it in Canada before.
Yeah, it is. It is quite alarming. And I think I want to ask the broader question of what kind of a culture does this type of legislation cultivate or create? Like, it feels like it's such a weaponization of ideology and even the definition of hate. I don't see how this couldn't create almost like a civil war type dynamic. Because let's face it, you have hateful people on both sides of the spectrum. Like, I know people in the faith community that are more, you know, soft conservatives that have been absolutely barraged with hateful attitudes, hateful things that have already been said about them from the people on the left, and vice versa. There's some pretty, you know, hateful comments coming. So both sides will be able to weaponize this. And will that not create almost like a culture of civil war? Could you bring commentary into that?
Well, I can tell you that we have already come through a time where we had one neighbor against another over the COVID-19 pandemic, where governments were, in essence, encouraging the populace to report on the activities of neighbors. We saw that firsthand, and I think that was kind of like a prelude. And to me, it's only just a preface to what kind of activity would come as a result of this act coming into law. We have seen it in historical examples, whether it's the French Revolution. You know, you scream out "God save the king" during the French Revolution and your head is chopped off. You go into the Russian Revolution and you support the czar, or you stand up for the kulaks who are out in the country just simply farming, and you were executed. I mean, those are extreme examples, but we are talking about, we saw the extreme examples in the COVID, in the sense of people losing their jobs, losing their homes, et cetera, for their conscientious positions. What might we face in the future with this kind of legislation?
Yeah, Barry's absolutely right about that. And I think it's chilling that in the French Revolution, it was the Public Safety Committee that was, you know, taking people to the guillotine. And now we're going to have a Digital Safety Commission. And it's a little bit too much of an echo for me. Look, this is going to lead to a culture of people being even less willing to dialogue with people who have opposing viewpoints. And, you know, if you can calmly sit down and talk to people and hear their arguments, that's how we come to agreement. And that's how we avoid, you know, violence in society. And you can't really stop people from having opinions. You can just sort of suppress them and let it fester. And it's really important that we have conversations. And what this bill does in so many ways is make it frightening and scary for people to actually express their points of view. And I don't think we'll get anywhere if we can't have those debates. So I think those aspects of the bill really need to be sort of taken out of the bill and removed. And just the sort of child exploitation piece of it that I think all Canadians can agree with, be right, left in.
And if I may, one more thing, just think about the history of our own country. We have a parliament that in the House of Commons, we have the opposition sitting on one side, the government sitting on the other. There's exactly two sword lengths separating them. That to me is symbolic, but it's something that we have learned through history, that people have very strong opinions. And when they go to parliament, they speak, and there's to be freedom of speech in parliament. And we need to be able to do it without having the swords reaching each other. What this is doing is giving every citizen a sword, and that's a problem.
And I think you guys make a really good point. Like, do we not need to take ground as a society in terms of learning to hear one another's hearts, learning to try to understand one another's perspectives, even if we don't fully agree? But we need to come back to that place of civil discourse. And if people are afraid that even expressing something, perhaps even gently, that seems to be counter to what somebody else believes or feels strongly about, if even that type of a dialogue can be weaponized potentially, then where does civil discourse go? It just literally evaporates. And we have to ask the question of our leaders, is this the type of Canada that we want to build? Can't we separate these issues out, create maybe two pieces of legislation? Let's address the child porn issue over here, and let's address civil discourse over here. Final words, and where can people find out more about your good work? I know with your organization, Josh, you've actually got a whole section on the website that is dedicated to this particular bill, where people can email their member of parliament through the click of a button. Why don't you tell our viewers about that?
Yeah, that's right. So just go to the CCF's website, which is theccf.ca. Right on our homepage, you'll find that that form where you can express your concerns directly to your MP. And I just got a report this morning that this is one of our most successful petitions ever. So I think if people keep going and the momentum builds, so that we might get some changes to this law. And so, yeah, I hope you'll do that.
Yeah, and you've got some videos up there. I know Christine Van Gijn, who works with your organization, also has a column in the National Post on this topic. So you've got some incredible resources. Barry, how about your organization?
So if they go to firstfreedoms.ca, and there you'll have access to our podcast and also our blog. And we're actually in the process right now of preparing material as well. And I think it's extremely important to recognize that all of these civic organizations like CCF, which was, I just want to give a plug for how great it was that Justice Mosley gave a real great shout out for their great work. And so, Josh, I just want to thank you for the work that you guys are doing, and keep it going, because we need you guys, and we need all of these organizations. And so for the public to reach out and support, it's very, very important.
Wonderful. Any final words for our viewers before we sign off here? Josh?
I think people just need to ask themselves, you know, how can you be against hatred, right? How can you be against bullying? Well, the problem is who defines what's hatred and who defines what's bullying? And it's really important for us to not criminalize speech, because those accusations fly really easily, and you don't want to have, you know, some government bureaucrats deciding whether or not you're allowed to say what you wanted to say.
Justice Ivan Rann, in the 1953 Supreme Court of Canada decision, referenced that freedom of speech is the first, or one of the first of the original freedoms. And I think that as a country, we have got to recognize that if we are going to advance together, and if we're going to be able to have peace on this real estate with that we call Canada, we've got to have freedom of speech. And this is a bill that's going to just absolutely prohibit free speech.
Well, that's the closer right there. Thank you so much for your time today, guys. Thank you for your good work. And thank you for providing these incredible resources for us. We'll be watching you both.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining me again this week for another very eye-opening conversation on C-63, the Online Harms Act, and its possible implications if passed. If you want to watch this interview again and share it with your friends, you can do that anytime by going to Faytene.tv, where this program will be posted along with other previous episodes. If you're ever having a hard time finding a show that we've aired in the past, just email our team and we'll be happy to help you locate it. If you'd like to give a special gift or sign up to become a monthly partner so that we can continue to produce and air these important conversations across our nation, we would be so grateful. Just give us a call at 1-866-844-0844 to give securely over the phone, or to give online, visit Faytene.tv. On our site, you can also sign up for our email list so that you never miss a show. Lastly, if you have a question about faith or if you have a personal prayer request, just give our team a call and we would be honored to chat with you and pray with you and answer any questions that you might have. Thanks again for joining me. Hope to see you next week.